Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE's live coverage here in San Francisco. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE with Dave Vellante, breaking down all the action. John Olsik, Jack McGuire, our lead analyst in security, out on the floor, tuning in theCUBE. Of course, getting all the action. SiliconANGLE team is getting all the news. Great event, day three, conversations across the board, replatforming, how to defend, and of course, how do you integrate all these products? Ryan Hebert's here, back from last year, head of cyber assurance. New role at ICE, the parent company to the NYSC, as part of the NYSC Wired Community and theCUBE partnership. Ryan, great to see you, welcome
great
back.
Great to see you too, thanks for having me guys. Good to see you all, thank you.
Role.
It's exciting, yeah. I had a similar role about 10 years ago when we were tiny and had about 20 people in cyber, but now we have 195, so I've got half of that. So, went from being the individual contributor as a business information security officer for New York Stock Exchange, fixed income and data services. Fantastic experience. Now we've got a new person running that shop, Priya Kuchalapati. She's wonderful. We got her from our Ellie Mae acquisition. She's been running strategy for all of cyber for the whole company for about 5 years now. She's going to fit in perfectly. So now I'm back on the practitioner side. I've got half of cyber. So I've got GRC, AppSec, Red Team, and a little splice of cloud. So
yeah, talk about the relationship with ICE. A lot of folks know this, some don't. ICE is the parent company of NYSC. It is a massive operation.
Yeah,
billions of dollars in revenue. A lot of going on, and you get a lot of data.
Oh my God!
And everyone wants that data. The bad guys do. I mean, it's not an easy job. Talk about ICE. Quickly, and then we'll get into some of the commentary.
Sure, yeah, it was a beautiful play by our founder, Jeff Sprecher. So he started as a derivatives trading exchange, brought a physical exchange online in Atlanta. Enron went over, everybody came to us. They were knocking production over probably 3 times a day for the first month. But we got our wits about us and figured it out. Then we built a clearinghouse, so a guarantee fund in the middle. If someone falls over like an MF Global or a Lehman Brothers, we're able to have that cash in the middle to pay out all of their options that they had open to the other side. So that was a really good foray into the derivatives trading world. Based upon that, he bought the New York Stock Exchange in 2013, so we went into equities, and then we've done a lot in the mortgage technology space. So the average time for a mortgage was 57 days. We brought that down to 8, from walking into the house saying you want to buy it to executing the deed.
So that built a ton of trust.
And that's 43 business units of data. Yeah. And why not give it to everybody that wants it in any facet or any capacity that they want, right?
Yeah, and as they say, the bad guys want the cheddar, or they want the cheese, which
they
is the data. and you have to defend on that. What's it like these days? Obviously AI is key to success here at the show. What is your view on the landscape? Because now you have, you probably do what, 3-4 jobs? That's a theme here. AI is going to augment. What is your position on this? What's your take on it?
Yeah, so about 10 years ago, Jeff started this narrative called stay lean, stay ahead, right? So we're always looking forward. If you don't have 3 jobs at ICE, you're not doing your job. That's just how it goes. So partnering a lot with Brian Bauman on our NYSC capital markets team to outreach to the VCs and the funds of what's coming out next. We had a guy who rebuilt the entire infrastructure under NYSC called Pillar into one clean infrastructure that lives in our data center. He's now shift roles. He does that still in support, but he's running our AI Center of Excellence. That's Anand Pradhan.
Yeah.
And then my head of AppSec and Red Team, which we call ART because it is an ART, AppSec Red Team, Craig Lambert has been helping us in this AI working group. So it's a quick and dirty group of 3 people, Anand, Craig, and myself.
What can you tell us about your AI Center of Excellence? What is that?
What's
the genesis of it?
So Anand's reaching out to all of the different DeepSeek, and he's building OpenAI and every Llama. He's working with Meta, everybody. So he's building out all these air-gapped orchestral underpinning language model builders. And he has a splash page for every developer or user in the company to offer up a productivity use case. So he sprints them in order of priority, builds the model directly defined to what they need and the data classification set that they need, drops it in our data center, and off they're running. It's beautiful.
Yeah.
So this is for on-prem?
On-prem only for only internal use cases, right? But that gives us a good playing ground to understand what we need to do to provide for our customers on that data services side.
Yeah, and also you're seeing that center of excellence from an engineering standpoint. A leader steps up in an organization. This is the pattern we're seeing. I was talking to John Rose yesterday. He said Michael Dell said, you know, his job might go out of business because he's also the CTO. So a lot of people are stepping up in these roles to lead and kind of be the threaded leader, if you will, to use an Amazonian term. And then once that's done, the theory is AI is everywhere. There's no real AI leader once it's done. What's your reaction to that? You agree?
I mean, that's the goal. As you said, 3 jobs at one time. I would love to have an agent doing half of the work that I need to do, right? securing all of the infrastructure at the endpoint, ensuring all of our ingress and egress controls are working properly, taking down all these horrible manual processes that are still at a state of requirement from a regulatory standpoint. My SOC group has 750 AR tickets to go through a day. On top of that, they're getting 550 phish failures that are really a spam email, right? I want an agent to be able to curate and define all of these easy menial Sev5 tasks, put a English-driven root cause analysis into the cyber ticket, and close it out so it's ready to go for the SEC.
Yeah, I mean the phishing and the also social engineering, Proofpoint was just on theCUBE yesterday, the CEO, they're growing rapidly because social engineering is on everyone's mind, it's what everyone's afraid of, because that is where the attack vector, the user piece. I know from getting emails from ICE and NYSC, you guys are hardcore on the user piece. What's your take on this whole social engineering category? Because you got the data.
Yeah, we had trouble providing folks in our NYSC office in San Francisco an opportunity to demo for us because their emails weren't coming through. So they all get mad at me because the demo can't go through, and I'm like, hey, you're welcome.
Got to keep the data safe.
That's right. So as these agents are building these fierce phishing campaigns, it's becoming really curated and directly attributed to the user based on the information they can glean from the data online. Yeah. But Proofpoint has been a huge friend in this space. It feels like every time I have a problem in any sort of orchestral space with data, Proofpoint's like, we got you, buddy. Yeah. They're going to help us with our DLP on Macs, which is a 15-year problem that no one's been able to crack. They're going to help us on mobile DLP as well. And the sphere phishing has gone down significantly based on them. So thank you to Sumit and Proofpoint for sure.
Going back to what you said about agents, what has to happen? What steps do you have to take such that you trust those agents?
I made a joke yesterday that we need to build an agent that's monitoring the agents. Someone laughed and I was like, I'm kind of serious. Just the beautiful thing that Anand's doing with this AI Center of Excellence, he's got six people that are doing constant data analysis in RAG, confirming all the manual steps that they expect to see. And then I was concerned, my AppSec team was champing at the bit to go and do a web application pen test on all of the models he was building. I was like, guys, you gotta wait, it's not built yet. So I go down and I was like, tell me when you're ready for us to pen test it. He goes, let's go. Right now.
Yeah, really?
I want that context. Beat it up. So we started doing prompt injections, forcing hallucinations. And he's like, maybe I didn't want this. You know what? That's what you do. You kill it yourself.
Stand down.
Exactly.
People love to break shit. They love to do that.
Oh, man, I
so
love
red
it.
Teaming has been the theme on the model side. I want to get your thoughts on this, because this is exactly what the conversations are in the hallways. Red teaming is not a new concept, but with models, red teaming is a strategic piece of the puzzle because it's generative, it's non-deterministic. So red teaming is a critical strategy. Explain that.
I never thought in 16 years as a practitioner that I'd be doing as much business development as I'm doing now. But it's just organic, right?
Yeah.
You're talking to all the funders and all the founders of companies that are working through VCs, and you're getting that insight into what they're doing. And through NYSC Wired and working with you guys, I have all that connectivity, right? So I've had four times this week someone has asked me about one specific pen test company, and it's just been the easiest response ever. They're doing exactly what I expected them to do. It's a company called Expo. I don't know if you've heard of them yet, but four different VCs are asking about it because they want to jump in on it. What they're doing is they're building an agent that'll drop into your intranet, and we will purposefully drop admin credential canaries throughout our production iterations. So it has to navigate through our infrastructure quietly without Blue Team finding it and pick up all those canaries. It's essentially an agentic capture the flag.
Yeah.
So we just push go and back up, get the results. It creates an English curated, data driven, regulatory ready pen test report in clear fashion of how the exploit happened and how it worked.
I mean, back in the old days, honeypots was the big thing. It's so easy to do. This brings up a couple things I want to get your thoughts on, because the NYSC Wired community is growing so fast because a trust network's being built, because sourcing and discovering information around what's working is on everyone's mind these days. So this idea of the collaboration, security's always been a collaborative team sport.
Has to be.
That's been talked about, so it's not really something that's new. But as the velocity of the pace of play is so fast, how important are these relationships? And if you talk to other practitioners, these trust networks that are forming, these watering holes of the tribe, if you will.
That's right.
How important is this? Because it's like not like a LinkedIn. It's like everyone's on WhatsApp or Telegram, whatever tools that they use, Slack or whatever. The communication's high velocity, high fidelity. What's your view on this whole wired wave?
So when I started 16 years ago, there was an open email bridge with all the CISOs in the financial services space, right? So my boss would just reply in, dropping in indicators of compromise. That's how they did it. We called ourselves the CISO frenemies. right? So we're talking CME, NASDAQ, all the financial services, also Bank of America, you know, Visa, MasterCard. And that formulated into a group called the FSISAC. So that's a huge threat intel feed for us. It's 12,000 banks. They made a subgroup called the ARC. It's the 19 critical infrastructure, market utilities, and financial services companies. So I'm on the risk committee, I'm the PMO for the company. Through that relationship, that's what's really drawn all of the institutions that are financial, listed on the New York Stock Exchange, are exact direct enemies, in terms of frenemies of the derivatives exchange. So using the threat intel feed has built a lot of the trust to go beyond that. And like, let's say, what kind of tools are you using? What are you seeing?
Yeah.
We got a response on a SEV2 from one of our enemies that accidentally saw an IP address that was allocated to us. Saved the bacon for us, right? And we're doing the same for them. So using that, and then having you guys on the floor, meeting with all the CEOs of these companies that are coming out, and Brian Bauman over in our NYSC Wired group, we're bringing all the founders that understand what our needs are together with the listed companies and all the other financial institutions.
Yeah. You called it a trust community. I mean,
it's a trust community, exactly.
Yeah. And what's happening is it's like a domain expert, it's like a domain, it's like a TLD, it's like a domain group of people.
That's right.
On top of the IP addresses, their little LinkedIns or whatever tools they got. I mean, it's not
And
like,
I don't have to use my top secret clearance.
Yeah, look at that, look at that. And again, this is the value of the information economy. And we think a result of that will be a marketplace of ideas, marketplace of value. This is new. It's Amazing. Growing like a weed, and I can't be more bullish on it. And it's going to change conferences. It's going to change relationships, hiring, deals, business growth. Huge opportunity.
Getting all together in a room at RSA and then going back over to Black Hat in the next couple months, we're so excited to all get in a room and just open dialogue, right? We've done it forever with Threat Intel. Let's do it for what we're using to beat the bad guys down, right?
The security industry really is a canary in the coal mine, to use that word you just mentioned, because it's highly data rich, data protection, collaborative and sharing, you mentioned that, and they're using AI practically. They're not like, you know, just suckers, hey, shiny new toy.
That's right.
They want legit, proven, the bar's high on resilience, okay, we get that, that's another AppSec review kind of concept, but AI is definitely, people are leaning into it. What's your reaction to that, do you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. We use a Fibonacci principle for rolling out different copilots. We started with Microsoft Copilot, now it's fully out to the entire enterprise. We have an 85% hit rate on people using it in the company. Never expected that number that high that quick. Now we're rolling out GitHub Copilot. We've gone 1%, 9% to the development group. Now we're getting 65% use out of the development team. They're arguing 75% productivity gains using a GitHub Copilot. But when, again, with Anand and the AI Center of Excellence, we're also beating down individual contextualized models and agents for our developers, explicit use cases for building code.
Did you see Satya with Zuck? He said 30% of our code is now being developed by AI.
And I love it.
I mean, that's a big chunk.
And Peter McKay at Sneak is taking it all in and giving me a recommendation based on another agent, how to fix it. Yeah. Automatic orchestral before it goes to QA fix without a developer having to jump back in, without my AppSec team having to go and scream at him and say, please close this ticket for the love of God.
I love this idea of a physical event, digital first party relationship with a network. What you're getting at with this now code assistance, it's a sharing, it's a digital version of sharing real product.
That's right.
So it's impacting the product side.
Yeah. We can all get together in a room and talk candidly about exactly what's working, what's not, and how two different companies that are doing the same product, where one might be at NASDAQ, one might be with NYSC, are in the room with both of us. And they're talking about how what they're trying to do to work together and work with us to fit our needs. It's amazing. I've never seen anything like it.
I love that collaboration. I mean, I don't think it would have happened, 15 years ago, the same way anyway, although it's interesting to hear that.
I agree.
But now, the industry realizes it's not a zero-sum game. The market's enormous. So
huge.
Let's protect and win.
Yeah, the goal here is to avoid the, we don't want to end up where everybody's using the same three owners of every tool set, right? We want to have that sprawl. We don't want to have an ancestral relationship because that gives you resilience, right?
Yeah.
When you've got multiple platitudes of opportunity to use agentic for secure or to defeat the users of agentic on the outside, having multiple opportunities to do that with different companies where they can all rise up in the harbor together is table stakes.
At the same time, Ryan, are you trying to at least somewhat reduce the number of vendors and tools in your security stack, and to what degree are you able to do that?
That's the tough game we play, right? So I am always looking at the things coming out of stealth, but I hope in some capacity that they'll be able to fan out to three different budget points, right? Three different threat objectives. So I do want to fan them out, but I also want to combine down where you've got six different vendors that are doing the same thing. give them opportunities to do other things and then beat down that threat objective and move them to something else, right?
Well, Ryan, we really appreciate your sharing and your leadership and helping us with theCUBE get the data. Readiness is a big topic. Our vendors ready. There's a lot of great companies here at RSA. Everyone's here. It's got the business and the tech. It's got sandboxes. What's your view of the landscape and what's your plan for the second half of the year in terms of what you're looking to do, events you're going to be at? What's the landscape look like and what's on your agenda for the rest of the year?
Yeah, RSA is more the CISO's conference. Black Hat is the practitioner's one, right? So I brought 5 people here. I have 36 people coming with me to Black Hat.
Okay. They're,
it's education, it's informing their peers, it's doing red teaming together. It's the collaboration on that side. So I'm excited to have, hopefully, you guys with us in Black Hat.
Oh, we'll be there.
We'll have NYSC Wired as well.
Yeah, 100%.
Introducing ourselves to all the new things coming out of that summit that's coming through Black Hat with the Innovation Hub, and us having our own NYSC Launchpad, bringing companies out into the forefront.
And you guys got a lot of data. Is there plans to share some of that data? Because we're going to have a big campaign in the fall around, you know, trying to squint through the fog and get data on what is readiness, what our benchmarks look like. I know Anand's got a lot of data too. Plans to share that?
It's almost as if you read my mind. We're building an agent to provide all of the data from all of these conversations that we're having and provide it out to everyone who wants to see it, especially through SiliconANGLE.
Awesome.
Ryan, thanks for coming on theCUBE. Really appreciate it. Great to see you again.
See you
back
too, brother.
Again.
Thank
Cube
you so
alumni.
Much.
Nice
to see you
Ryan
there.
Hebert here,
head
of cyber assurance at ICE, a big operation. They got a lot of data on-prem too. It's the crown jewels, of course. You got to protect them. theCUBE bringing all the data here at RSA. Thanks for watching.
Thanks.